sharing of family and friends. And we'll all join hands and remember this moment till the season comes round again. Let's all try to smile for the picture, and we'll hold it as long as we can. May it carry us through, should we ever get lonely, till the season comes round again.
Stand with me as we ask God's blessing on our service today. Lord, we pray that you would touch each of our hearts, and I pray, O Lord, for your blessing to be on this time that we have gathered in your name. We honor you, Lord. We lift you up, and we say from the bottom of our heart how grateful we are that we can look forward into another year, knowing that you are already there, you're already here. And Lord, we give you ourselves and we give you our lives and we give you this service now. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Well, it's good to see you all. And I hope you had a good Christmas. And we'll see tonight, I guess, how good a New Year we had. New Year's Day. We have a whole year, though, to think about New Year's, I was thinking about that saying that says Jesus is the reason for the season. I was thinking about some of the things that we find in the Bible. Jesus is the reason for everything, really. Paul said, in him we live and move and have our being. In another place he said, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. It's all about Jesus. And so we have gathered in the name of Jesus today to worship him. Do we have some announcements? As I know everybody's been thinking about getting through the last few days, the holidays. I call them the holy days. Which holiday really means. So, anyway, does anyone have an announcement that as we look forward? Yes, Nancy.
Mark was moved yesterday to rehab. He's in Warwick, and Bob is going to see him now. I sent a message to her. I don't know if she'll text back before he went to church to get his address. So, as soon as I get it, I'll let him know. Yeah, so. Oh, there are a few announcements in the bulletin. Read them, please.
And Mark assured me that he is going to be watching this morning. So, hi, Mark. Are there others? Okay.
We have a business meeting this Tuesday night. Via Zoom, 7 o'clock.
Okay. Does everybody affected hear that? 7 o'clock for a deacon's meeting? Yes, what? Yeah, we have, there's a deacon's meeting at 7 o'clock on Tuesday.
Business
meeting. I'm sorry. I read lips. I'm sorry. I can't help it. Okay. Yeah, it's good to have a bulletin, and thank you for making a nice bulletin again. Okay, well, Mary is going to come and share our call to worship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This morning as I got up, I was so excited to see the sunshine and just the beautiful day. And I was thinking, I'm like, oh, it's a new year and it's a Sunday. And so I want to wish everybody a happy new year. And I just pray that this year God gives us a lot of love, a lot of joy. And I know sometimes many of us have trials, but that he gives us strength as we endure our trials, because he is faithful and he'll never let us down. Psalm 100, shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful song. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
Well, that was a fun song, wasn't it? Very moving, and I don't know, the creativity with the photography and putting it all together was just beautiful. Anyway, thank you, Jackie, and the worship team. We really appreciate your faithfulness week after week, and boy, we just thank the Lord that he's brought us through last year, and we can trust him for the future too. Amen. Well, does anyone have something you'd like to thank God for? Maybe right off the bat, it would be good if you could just say something that God has done for you or you're expecting God to do for you in 2023. 2022 was a good year in a lot of ways. Somebody said, yeah, it was hard too. And I say, yeah, but most of them are. But here we are with a new slate. Yes.
I had a rough year this past year, as most of you know, and I'm glad the rough time is over, and I'm looking forward to this year to be able to get out, maybe walk some, you know, a little bit better and get along. But I also have a prayer request. Pastor Dennis and Patty both have COVID, so pray for them.
Okay, so we'll pray for them, yes. Yes, Julie.
I have a prayer. As of Friday, I do not have my other job. And boy, am I thankful.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you were faithful, though. You were faithful.
I retired 6 years ago.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Just made it official 2 days ago. That's good. Yes, Mary.
I just praise God. Again, at Christmas, this church, it's just really blessed me and my kids, and we were able to feed 19 families. So we made huge boxes for them to go home with, and we gave them some gift cards to go shopping. So I just praise God that he always is faithful and true to, you know, when I ask him and my food pantry is bare, I come to church and I just say a little jingle, and you guys truly answer God's prayer because you guys just bless me to bless them. And we should pray for Pastor Ruth and Pastor Warren. They have COVID and their family, just that God may be with them too.
Yeah.
I have another praise.
Okay.
I was thinking about this, as you know, Don Hoyle passed away this past year, and Bill was helping with the flower arrangements and was for a funeral. And he, as he does all the time, he helps, he's just that type of a guy. And he said, boy, I don't think I'd like to do this. So he has been doing that. He's been working for Hope Funeral Home. And let's see, I think 3 times, and now he's working Wednesday and Thursday. So he's working and I'm not.
Yeah.
You better. God says about that.
A new place. Yes. Good. Yes, Jackie.
Can you pray for Jim Hagan? I haven't heard anymore, but last night he had a blood clot in the brain.
Okay. Yeah, yes.
Can you tell about Lisa?
Sure. Yeah, I just want to mention a week ago, of course, was Christmas, and we were at Lisa's house, our daughter's house, for the day with all of the family was together, and it was a wonderful day, but it was kind of overshadowing it was knowing that on Tuesday morning she had to be down in New York for some pretty serious surgery. They were going to put plates and pins and screws in her to stabilize the pelvic area. She had 2 vertical fractures and 1 lateral fracture, and anyway, they did the surgery on Tuesday, started about 11:30, and that evening she woke up and they had her up on her feet a little bit that day, and but she said it immediately she felt better. It was less pain than she'd had for quite a while. And the next day they had her up walking and And she said, I want to go home. And all the staff down there, I mean, these are medically hardened people that have seen it all. They said, we have never seen anybody recover from or be able to do what you're doing so quickly after surgery. And Lisa said, well, I have a lot of people praying for me. And one lady piped up and said, boy, that prayer is powerful stuff. And we know prayer, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man or woman is strong. It does the work. And we praise the Lord for Lisa. She is home. And I saw her yesterday and has a slight fever. They said that was kind of normal because she's had, you know, very serious surgery. If you want to see the picture of her hardware, you go, I can show you, but you just say, wow, how could they even do that? But she's doing well. Thank you. Are there others? Didn't mean to go into so much detail, but you've all been praying for her. After a while, you sort of feel like you're a part of what people go through, and I hope someday you'll have a chance to meet her. She's just an amazing lady. Let's stand together as we pray. Oh God, we are so thankful that we can trust you with our lives and with our hopes and dreams of the future. And Lord, we do pray for those who are struggling today. We think of Pastor Ruth and Warren, and we think of Mark, and think of Lisa and others, Lord, that maybe are just not feeling 100%, but we pray that you would bring them through and give them strength. And I pray for our family members wherever they are too. I pray for those who are struggling. I pray for those who just aren't living right. And I pray, God, that you would give them a different course that they would follow this year. And Lord, we pray for our community. We pray that you would touch the hearts of people and draw them to yourself. I pray that this year there would be people that we know that would get saved, and they would have a desire to follow you and serve you with their whole heart. And so, Lord, we don't know what's ahead, but we know we can trust you with whatever it is. And we pray this in all things in your name. Lord, you taught us to pray that wonderful prayer, and we pray it too. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Please stay standing, and we're going to sing some more.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me,
So this is Joshua chapter 1. I'm going to read the first 9 verses. I'll read and you can follow along in your Bible. Joshua 1, 1 through 9. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people, get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land that I am about to give them, to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon and from the great river, the Euphrates, all the Hittite country, to the Mediterranean Sea to the west. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their ancestors to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. And that is the word of the Lord and the backdrop of my message this morning. This song is kind of a long time coming. I love the phrase you hear often in an African-American church, a congregation, or people in an African-American church might say this, and you might recognize it: the Lord has brought me from a mighty long way. And I thought, wow, what a beautiful way to say God has been faithful. And so that's the name of this song, Mighty Long Way. And as soon as Christina learns it, she'll sing it with me. But today, I'm doing it. I just thought it was appropriate for the first day of the year. Darkest hour when we had lost our way. You loved us, sought us, you gave your life and bought us. Lord, you have brought us from a mighty long way. You have brought us through some fiery trials of life's adversities. And you have been there in the wilderness and met our every need. Our lives were broken, but you have spoken your promises so true. Lord, we believe and trust that you will safely bring us through. Oh Lord, you have brought us from a mighty long way. Steep through some valleys deep, you have led us by your grace. You shined your light in the darkest hour when we had lost our way. You loved us, sought us, you gave your life and bought us. Lord, you have brought us from a mighty long way. know that change is inevitable and things will be different in some parts of our future than they have been in the past. And sometimes that means a decline in our ability, and maybe it means more responsibility in the days ahead. But change is inevitable. It's difficult, though. We develop our own way of doing things. In fact, one of the sayings you hear people say, if you want something done right, you have to? Of course. We know what's right, don't we? Of course, other people may not agree with that, but we know. And we develop our way of doing things, and it doesn't matter if it's in our house. For example, you can probably walk through your house in the dark from one end to the other. Now, you go to somebody else's house and it might be different. But you have a way of doing things because you're home. That's part of the wonderfulness of being home. You can do your thing. Or at work, you have your way of doing your job. At school, I don't know if anybody is actually taking classes right now, but you know what it is to have a way of doing things. Or we even have our own way of doing things at church. Even non-liturgical churches have a tradition that they sort of follow. We have a tradition here at Blackstone, the way the service is supposed to go. Now, somebody else could come in, and they would say, why are they doing that? It's because that's what we do. We know it's the right way to do it. But it's hard to cope with being expected to do things that are somebody else's job. Why did they make me do that? Why did they have me do that? And today we're going to be looking at Joshua. And Joshua was a wonderful man that God used to lead the children of Israel. And so I want to look at that. The first couple of verses, it says, after the death of Moses. So that really puts a pin on the map of where this, what was happening at this time. Moses was dead. And for Joshua, this was the opening of the chapter that would be the greatest part of his life. Now, maybe not the longest part, but it was the greatest part of his life. He had been one of the leaders of Israel's armies, the main leader of the armies, but one of the other leaders of Israel, kind of like an advisor or an assistant to Moses for a long time. At the Battle of Amalek, when the children of Israel were soon out of Egypt, Moses was sitting on a rock watching the battle before him. Aaron was on one side holding up an arm, and Hur on the other side, two of the Levitical priests, and they were, as long as Moses' arms were up, the Israeli armies were winning. The man down in the valley leading the fight was Joshua. Joshua was the general. But now he was starting this biggest role of his life, at least the most obvious and visible role. But nothing that had happened in previous years were wasted. And I like that, because God was with Joshua all the way through, from the time he was a little boy learning the things of God, and watching Moses and being around Moses. All of that was a part of what God was doing to prepare him for this big role. All the things that have happened to you in your life, and I can say even the things that have happened to you in the last 12 months, none of those have been wasted. God uses those things and brings good even out of the bad. Only he could do that. One of the great verses of the Bible, I think, is Romans 8:28. And we know that all things work together for good. They're not all good, but they work together for good to those who love God and those who are called according to his purpose. So we understand that God is working, or we should understand that God is working in our life, even in the hard times. And we have hard times, don't we? Can I hear somebody say amen? That should be a big amen. We go through hard things. And you say, man, I don't know if I can do this. This is really hard. But Joshua went through hard things too. Joshua was right at Moses' elbow when Moses went as a personal assistant, when Moses went up the mountain, Mount Sinai, to get the law. He was there when they came down together and saw the children of Israel dancing around the golden calf. He was probably thinking some of the same things that Moses was thinking when Moses was just burned up. Oh, he was mad. And he threw the tablets down and had that golden calf that ground up, and then he made the children of Israel drink the water. You want gold, you want a calf, here. But he was there. He stayed near the tabernacle. I looked up who Joshua was, and Joshua wasn't a Levite. He was from the tribe of Ephraim, and Joshua, son of Nun, who was an Ephraimite. His name is Yeshua, or Hosea, or Joshua, and so he was one of the 12 spies that Moses sent into the land of promise, into Canaan, before the Israelites went in. And there were 2 spies that came back with a good report, and 10 came back with the bad report. And Caleb and Joshua were the 2 that came back with the good report. So Joshua was one of the good guys. He was always one of the good guys. He was there for Moses. He was faithful. He was a hard working guy. He stood for the truth. And together with with Caleb, when they came back from the promised land, they were the ones that said, God is able. Our God is able. Yeah, there's giants there. We know there's giants there, but it's a land flowing with milk and honey. And our God is able to give it to us. It doesn't matter how big the giants are. It doesn't matter what's there, what the obstacles are. It doesn't matter how wide the river is to get across it. Our God is able. We need to go in and possess the land. Well, they were the 2 that said that. And the multitude of the nation went with the other 10 spies. And we don't really know very much about them. But Caleb and Joshua were the ones that stood for the truth. They were nearly stoned to death for the stand of faith that they took, though. In Numbers 14, it says the people, after they came back and said, we're able, let's go take the land. The people took up stones and were going to stone Joshua and Caleb. But Joshua got the call from the Lord in verses 2-9 of the words that we read. Moses, my servant, is dead. Now arise and go over the Jordan. I'm putting you in charge. You take them across, Joshua. God spoke. Joshua listened. And I don't know if he might have been saying, I'm not Moses. I can't. Who am I? But God said, be strong. 4 times in this chapter, the words be strong are there. 4 times. And God is speaking to Joshua and telling him, don't back off from what I give to you. I'm telling you, you can do it. You can do anything. Because I'm with you. So God spoke, Joshua listened. Didn't seem like anything Joshua did was the easy road, though. You know how some people live life and it seems like everything they do is they do it the hard way. We have somebody in our family, and we just sometimes shake our head and say, why doesn't she just do it the easier way, the way that her parents are telling her to? But things happened fast. First, he was leading the army just probably hours or very short time later, he was leading the nation. So it was, and then Joshua spoke. In verses 11 through 15, he told the people what God had told him. He was the mouthpiece of God. He said, God's able, and he's going to take us through and pass through the camp, prepare provisions, purify yourselves, get yourselves ready, get packed up. We're going across the Jordan. We're going in to possess the land that God gave us. And so he was, I love the verse 9. That God spoke to Joshua, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." That was one of the verses that I heard over and over at the beginning of the pandemic 3 years ago. Do you remember that? You would hear that verse, Joshua 1:9. Be strong and of good courage. And we got through. Here we are on the other side of it. We didn't all die. We know of people who did. But here we are. We stand as testaments to God's ability to bring us through. I laugh when I read this chapter, and down in verse 16, the people responded to all the things that Joshua was telling them. And he said, "Oh, as we heeded Moses, we're going to heed you." And I laugh and I say, well, at least they were honest about it. They were about as obedient to what Joshua had to say as they were to what Moses had to say. Moses sometimes was pulling out his hair because the people were complaining and whining and speaking against him and against the food. Complaining against the not having enough water. It was all together. Why did you bring us out here to die? And then Joshua, it's not very long if you read further down, the people are saying the same thing to Joshua. Why did you bring us here? What are you doing? Do you even know what you're doing? And why are we here? So they were saying, as we heeded Moses. Now, it wasn't saying much, but they were honest about it. The people affirmed the words that God had spoken to Joshua earlier in verse 18. He says, "Only be strong and of good courage." There's another repeating phrase through this chapter, and I had not noticed it until just yesterday, actually. And it's the Lord your God, the Lord your God, not the Lord or God, but the Lord your God. 5 times in this chapter, you can read those words. The Lord your God is giving you rest and is giving you this land. And take possession of the land which the Lord your God is giving them. And only the Lord your God be with you. And then go in and take possession which the Lord your God is giving you. And so over and over, the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. And we can know that the Lord is our God. He's not just the God or a God. He's not out there somewhere taking care of something else somewhere in the universe far away from us, but he's the Lord our God. He's our God. When we pray the Lord's Prayer, one of the great phrases of that prayer to me is the first 2 words, "Our Father." Well, in the first place, "Our Father" is very inclusive, that "our Father." We're declaring it together. It's "our Father." It's also exclusive because it's "our Father." You may not have a relationship with our Father, but our Father who is in heaven. And so it's a wonderful thing that we can say the Lord our God the same way. The Lord our God is going to be with us. There are several times in the book of Deuteronomy where we see those same words, be strong, be strong, be strong, and the words are to Moses or to the people or to Joshua. But we are also told to be strong in the Lord. Another verse that is in the New Testament that I love, it talks about being strong, is in Ephesians. Ephesians 6. And you will recognize the passage when I start reading it. Ephesians 6, 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you can stand against the wiles of the devil. Be strong in the Lord. And so Paul is saying that to the Ephesians and to us, be strong in the Lord. We are told to be strong because we have an enemy. We have an adversary. He's the devil. And he doesn't want good for us. Our challenge, though, is to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might so that we can stand against the devil. Time and again in the scripture, we see words that say, fear not, or don't be afraid. We're told we don't have to be afraid. We don't have to run for cover. We can be strong in the Lord. We tend to have fears that can hold us back. And they really slow us down, not just in the area of the fear, but in other things that might be beneficial and enjoyable for us. The fear of the unknown, the fear of pain or discomfort, the fear of loss. So many things. And they can hold us in this little place instead of being strong and trusting God no matter what. We have a little grandson that he's not so little anymore. It's amazing how they grow up, huh? But a few years ago, it was in his house that there were some foster kids that came to live for a while. And so he was maybe 3 years old, and he'd studied a little bit, you know, in some books and Bible story books, and Sunday school he'd studied about David and how David was a mighty warrior for God, and he slew the giant. And anyway, one night it was time to go to bed, and this little foster guy, he was probably 10 or 12 years old. He was afraid to go up the stairs to bed by himself. He was just afraid. It was well lit. It was just up some stairs, but he was afraid to go up there. And so he said, Aiden, would you go upstairs with me? Little Aiden went upstairs with, you know, the bigger kid. And up the stairs they would go. And we said, well, Aiden, weren't you afraid? He said, no, I'm a mighty warrior for God. I said, wow, he's got it. We are mighty warriors for God. We don't have to be afraid. We can be strong in the Lord. So Joshua's word from God was that he would be with Joshua as he was with Moses. He was going to be the same God to Joshua as he was to Moses. Now, I'm sure that Joshua's jaw dropped a few times when he watched the way God spoke to Moses and the way God used Moses. You know, can you imagine holding out or seeing somebody hold out a rod and the water opens? And he must have said, whoa, wow. Or just being down there in the valley fighting the Amalekites and seeing Moses, that man of God, up on the mountain. Man, he looked up there, keep your hands up, brother. Because he knew that Moses was a mighty man of God, but God said, I'm going to be with you as I was with Moses. Praise the Lord. So, we don't have to draw back. God doesn't change. I knocked a pen off and I was stepping on it. God doesn't change. So don't look back. Don't draw back. Don't say, oh, it's too hard. Well, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm filled with fear. But keep on trusting God. Trust God to keep leading you on, no matter what. Peter and John and Paul in the Bible don't have anything on us because we serve the same God that they did. It's just a few years later. We serve the same God Joshua served. It's just a few years, a few centuries later. As he was with them, he will be with us. He does not change. He is God. When Joshua was anointed to be the next leader of Israel by Eleazar the priest in Numbers 27, it says that the Spirit of the Lord was on him. In verse 18 of that chapter, Numbers 27:18. And the Holy Spirit from the Lord gave him boldness and faith. It filled him with boldness and faith. The Holy Spirit just made him mighty in God. Who are you, mountain? Who are you, Jordan River? Who are you, armies of Jericho? Who are you? Who are you? He wasn't afraid. Because he had the Holy Spirit living in him. And the Holy Spirit in us will inspire faith and give us the audacity to have faith, to believe for things that maybe would cause others to shrink back from. But we pull ourselves up in our heart, in our spirit, and we say, I'm not afraid. I'm not going to worry about it. I don't care what's ahead. You know the Bill Gaither song, Because He Lives, I Can Face Tomorrow? That's a great song, isn't it? Because Jesus lives, we can face tomorrow. There's another song I was thinking about, and I looked up who wrote it and when it was written. In 1950, a guy named Ira Stamphill wrote a song, I Don't Know About Tomorrow. I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sorrow, for the skies may turn to gray. I don't worry about the future. I know what Jesus said. And today, he walks before me because he knows what's ahead. Many things about tomorrow I don't understand, but I know who holds tomorrow. And I know who holds my hand. It's all the difference in the world, isn't it? No wonder Joshua could be strong in the Lord. So, as you look at the things in your life, there may be things even in the year to come that are daunting. There's a change afoot. I can tell you, there's changes that are going to be happening in your life. Now, for some of us, it may be subtle changes, it may be small changes, but I can guarantee that there will be things that you're not completely comfortable with. But they're going to happen anyway. And you can trust God to be with you, whether they're daunting and hard or whether they're wonderful and easy. God told Joshua that he would never leave him, he would never forsake him. And he says the same thing to us in Hebrews 13:5. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He's not going to leave you holding the bag. So I want you today to hear the words that God spoke to Joshua. Be strong. We might wonder what will happen to our loved one. And I say, be strong. We might have questions about what might happen to us. Be strong. We might wonder, well, what's going to happen at church? What's going to happen to Christ Community Church? Be strong. We might wonder, what's going to happen? We might not see things going the way we think they should go. We might see reversals. And I'm saying, be strong. Be strong. Joshua had been at Moses' side and seen the power of God. And we have seen with our own eyes the things that God can do. He hasn't changed. Believe and know that in Him you are more than a conqueror. So you can be strong. Be strong. Amen.
We all start on the outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give. Oh, the shape that we were in. And just when all hope seemed lost, love opened the door for us. He said, come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Liars and these thieves, there's no one unwelcome here. And that sin and shame that you brought with you, you can leave it at the door and let mercy draw you. To the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers and the princes, all who fail, you've been forgiven, all who dream and all who suffer, all who loved and lost another, all the chained and all the free, all who follow.
One of those wonderful traditions that we have here at Blackstone is having communion first Sunday. Once in a while, other times too. But pretty much count on communion Sunday, first Sunday of the month. This is not only the first Sunday of the month, but it's the first Sunday of the year, first day of the year.
What a perfect time to have communion and acknowledge what our Lord Jesus did for us, because that's really what communion is. We are reminded. We do this remembering Him, remembering the cross. We look back and with grateful hearts and we say, thank you, Lord Jesus, that you did that, gave your life so I could be free. And so we invite anyone who is here, any Christians, we know it's a real meaningful thing to us when we share communion together. One of the reasons I think it's meaningful is we're all eating the same thing at the same time. We're all thinking about the same thing at the same time. And it's like when we pray together and pray the Lord's Prayer together. It's a powerful prayer because we're doing it together. And I think that's so wonderful that we can. And when we come to the communion table and we're together like this, we can think of the people we know in our circle. And our circles all overlap. Pastor Mark there in the hospital, he's in our circle today. Our Lisa is in your circle. Others that you know that are struggling with physical needs, or emotional needs, or financial needs. We know that God is able, their circle overlaps our circle. So together we know that everything we need is represented in the communion. That's what Jesus did. So it says in 1 Corinthians, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. So, Lord, remembering that you are the bread of life, remembering that you gave your life, your body, to be crucified, to die in our place. You took our punishment for our sins, but you also took our diseases and our sicknesses in your own body so that we could be healed and free. By your stripes, we know we are healed. So, oh God, we pray that as we share this bread together, and as we drink from this cup together, pray, oh Lord, that we would know, Lord, that you've paid the full price. There's nothing else that needs to be done except for us to just receive the gift from you. We do in Jesus' name. So the night Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, he broke it, and said, this is my body given for you. We have a tray of bread, and it also has the wafers. And they have the wafer and the juice all in the same cup if you'd rather have that. Otherwise, we're going to be having the... So, remembering that night, let's eat the bread together.
Oh, the blood.
So because he has washed us with his own blood, let's drink this cup together, remembering that we are forgiven. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. I thank you for the blood of Jesus. Thank you for the blood of Jesus.